Okay, welcome back to the second session of the day. And it's going to be Alexander Wirth talking about salsa-debian.org.
Thank you, good morning. I usually don't give talks in English, so please be nice to me. However, I'm here. I want to talk today about our journey from Alioth, which is still running, but not long anymore, to our new service, Salsa. I want to get a little bit into the history of all things and what we have already achieved, what we still need to achieve, and what are our plans for the future. So let's start with the basic things. Who am I? I am the guy who rejects your mails on list7.org. I'm a list master. I am the guy that rejects your backports. I'm the backports FTP master. And I am the guy that will destroy alioth.debian.org. So I'm for the last 10 years, I was the admin by accident of alioth.debian.org. This is another story I will tell in a few minutes. And aside from that, I work as an open source consultant at Creditive, which is a small company in Germany, which is specialized in open source. We only do open source consulting in Germany. We do what today is called DevOps. We do every kind of consulting. If you do something with open source, we are probably the one you can talk with. I'm a father of two wonderful girls. They're not here, unfortunately, but otherwise I wouldn't be able to work. And in my little bit spare time, I do role-playing games and tabletop games. So in theory, there should be a picture now. There's a picture missing. I don't know why, which should tell we need you. If so, a little bit of advertisement. If you want to do open source work in Germany, paid, and you need a job, please talk to me. We are always looking for good people, especially in C development, kernel development, but also, of course, consulting. So please talk to me. Some steps in history. Some years ago, it was around 28, 29, I told the Alioth channel, hey, if you need help, I can help you with system administration, so not the GeForge stuff, which is running above, but if you need help, tell me. Yeah. 1 or 2 years went by, and step by step, all remaining Alioth admins left. We were alone in the channel. And around that time, I detected, hey, I have sudo permissions. And I'm admin. Somebody made me an admin. So I had to decide that I will be the person that is the future Alioth admin. And I stepped in. So this was the beginning of our Alioth journey. Then in DevCon 15, we had a longer birth of the FISA, where we talked about several security problems in CoLabMent. Some of you are maybe not aware of it, but since we use Git at file system level on Alioth, we are introducing a number of interesting security problems, like if someone writes a hook, that hook gets executed every time someone pushes. So you have basically shell access. And of course, you execute it as your own UID. So if some DM, or even not DM, nearly the whole world has wide access to CoLabMain, drops some hooks in, it can make you execute code on Alioth as at your UID, which is a problem. We did some things to solve that problem, but the main problem remained. So around that time, we decided that we will need a successor for Git debian.org. At that point, we are talking about Git2Lite, which we evaluated in that time. However, as it's somebody, something's happened, 2 years went into the land and nothing real happened. We just played with it. Then May 2017, threat came up, moving away from FusionForge. What nobody was really aware of is that Alioth is a Wheezy machine, and Wheezy is running out of security support end of the month. So time was running up. The threat was pretty long, as usual in Debian Devil, and we decided to do a few steps, like evaluating things. And in June 2017, I did a survey about our new Alioth services. It was clear at that point that I wouldn't be able to maintain all the things Alioth had in the future. So we decided to just bring over the important things. What is important? For everyone, everything else is important. So I decided to do a survey, which was pretty successful with a few hundred submissions. And then in irgendwas ist da faul. Then we evaluated, evaluated a few solutions named Pageur, which is the Git solution Fedora is using, which is a Python thing based on Gitolite, GitLab, which is the biggest GitHub component, competitive, thanks. And Gox -Gitea, which is some Golang-based small Git service. Pageur turned out to be not stable enough for our needs, and we would have to do too much coding inside Pageur to use it in our infrastructure, because Pageur is very strong bundled with the Fedora infrastructure, especially its user authentication and user management stuff. GitLab had another problem called Open Core and Computer License Agreement, which means I and others were not very happy with contributing code to GitLab, which is something that will always happen if you maintain such a service. And Gox and Gitea is nice, but it's small. It's not. It will not be able to manage 10,000 of repositories. Next step happened in August 2017, where we had a sprint here in Hamburg and at the Hacker Labs, the CCC, and the other side of the building, where we talked about it. After long discussions, we decided to go with GitLab, because GitLab at that point was the best solution that was already ready. We didn't have to adapt too much. We don't need to patch it, which turned out it isn't true, but that's another problem. It had features like continuous integration ready. It had features like code review ready, wiki pretty good working, and runner stuff. And it is very scalable in all directions. Every component is scalable, which is good for us. This is a to-do point. I wanted to add an image about the restaurant. We decided on the name Salsa. Somebody may ask, of you may ask yourself what the name is coming from. There's a small Mexican restaurant a few hundred meters from here, where you can get great burritos, and they have a painting in the back where the term Salsa written on, and we were deciding on a name which is which does not describe the type of service on it. So we wanted Yeah, it's also a source, and so Salsa at source, but I wanted to call it Klaus, but we decided against it. So somebody come up in that restaurant with the name Salsa, and so it's called Salsa. In the meanwhile, we talked a lot with the GitLab people, which were very kind and helped us with our problems. And we also talked with them about the CLI problem. And after some discussions, the lawyer of SPI was also involved. We made them to remove their CLA and replace it with something better. So contributing patches to GitLab is now much easier and better. Which is something we are very proud of. And between November and 25th December, we implemented Salsa 2 times. First time on goddarddebian.net, where we had root. But after more discussions, we decided having a DSA maintained box, .org box, would be better, which made us throwing away our Ansible stuff and develop it new to be able to install Salsa as a non-privileged GitLab as a non-privileged user. Which we did then. So in Christmas, we was able to release Salsa into public beta. Things went well, which allowed us at the end of January to Salsa to leave the beta. So since then, it's official. It's our official Git successor. What will happen in the future? No, it's already passed. On May, we disabled user and project creation on IDEOF. Still in May, we disabled the not so much used version control systems, like named Bazaar, Mercurial, and Darks. On Thursday, I disabled project websites. And this is future. At the end of the month, all other remaining version control systems on IDEOF will get disabled. So if you have anything running on IDEOF, still running on IDEOF, be it the controps are also disabled, so you don't have controps enabled anymore. Be it whatever you think of, remove it. With the 1st June, IDEOF will be off. You won't be able to get any data anymore from IDEOF. You can get the dance via DSA to get something from the backups. That's up to you, but I don't recommend it, and they won't like it. Yeah. In June, IDEOF will come to an end. It served us well for what I had. 10, 15 years, but it's time it's over. Some numbers. Where are we now? Yesterday, we had 23,700 repositories on GitLab with 3,200 users, 400 groups, which sums up around 90 gigabytes on disk, which is nice. For a service running for more or less 6 months, it's a pretty nice number, something. What are our future plans? Genau. We want a Docker registry. By now, you can use external registries, which is working. You can use the GitLab registry for Docker content images, but it would be more nice to have our own registry. This is pretty high on my to-do list after IDEOF is gone. We want more runners. So if you are able to sponsor runners, so if you have machines or some money you want to spend on runners, please tell us. What are runners? Runners are the things that are used by GitLab CI to build code or test code or do things. You can use it to build your packages. You can use it to auto package test your packages. You can use it to build Bev sites or whatever you like. It's pretty useful, and I think using CI more will be a big step forward for Debian. And we should really get more into it. There are already some projects like the Reproducible, the DebCI guys that are working on such stuff. And now we have the infrastructure that every DD, every developer or package maintainer can use it. There's also another feature called DevOps, which is based on Kubernetes, which allows you to even deploy and test things properly. So if you have a web package which implements a web service, you can even come up with a Kubernetes pod which runs your web server. You can test it, you can even record it, can do QA tests, and so on, all based on this DevOps feature, which would also be a nice thing. By now, we don't have a Kubernetes instance we can use for it. So if you have a spare Kubernetes instance you want to offer Debian, please talk to us. And integration with SSO Debian.org, which is another side project of me and my Summer of Code student sitting there. We want to build a successor for the current SSO Debian.org, which has a problem that it doesn't have a user backend. The user backend is Alioth. You see the problem, which is the case for all guest users. The official Debian developers come from UDLDAP, which will still work, but we have a problem with guest users. So we have currently don't have an authoritative source for managing those guest users, especially give additional groups like, hey, the user is a DM. I would love to give all DMs access to the Debian group, write access, but I can't currently because I'm not able to identify them, which is something we want to solve with the new SSO Debian.org feature. SSO Debian.org should also develop new authentication protocols like OAuth2, which will be used for Salsa, which new web services can also rely on. So that we come away from this certificate stuff, which is somewhat nice, but it's not that good integrated in most browsers anymore. And it doesn't work that well. We hope to have. We already have a prototype, and we hope to have it live into the end of the summer. What we left behind. We don't have shells anymore, so you won't be able to run any cron jobs or other stuff on Salsa. And please don't ask. We won't give anyone a shell on SalsaDebian.org or Godard, which is hosting it. We have APIs, several of them, I will show them, and please use them. We won't run any cron jobs or custom stuff on GitLab. It was a nightmare on Alioth to maintain and to administrate, and I will never want to get into it again. What we also don't have is custom domains, which is a feature GitLab has, but DSA decided against it. So you will have to live with project name .pages.debian.net until someone decides for that feature. We also left behind old version, also not so much used anymore, version control systems like Darks, Bazaar, Subversion, which isn't a problem. But we also don't have CVS anymore, which is maybe a surprise for someone. But Debian is still a heavy user of CVS, especially for our websites and translations. But maybe they will now faster with migrating away from CVS. They are working on it, I know. They're working on it for 10 years. But things are getting things are getting faster and they are making progress in migrating away from CVS. Yeah, stimmt. That's right. We also left Mercurial or whatever people had in their home directory. Yeah, we also had RCS on Alioth. There were as RCS repos. Yes. What we got instead? We got a bunch of new features we didn't have before. So this is such maybe start of new ways of working in Debian. We got a bunch of collaboration features. In the past, collaboration often meant finding the right mailing list, sending a patch, and hoping. Now we can use merge requests, which allows people to easily fork and modify packages or repositories. And after they are done, they can just hit a button or whatever and can create a nice merge request, which is already heavily used by some projects like apt or duck or my own redirector. That allows the administrators or the admins of those repositories dash projects to review code easily. They can add comments, they can discuss with those people, all without a mailing list. If people update their branch and hit committed, those pull requests get updated, which is a workflow we are also using very heavily in our company, which is pretty nice in my eyes. This also allows contribution to packages from outside people. It lowers the barrier for people to collaborate with Debian, which is, in my eyes, a good feature. It's something I already liked, always liked on GitHub, and I'm happy we are having it too now. GitLab has a nice feature of a good and well-designed web front end. Some things could be better, but that's always the case. But in most cases, GitLab is still blazingly fast, except if you hit some of the bugs in the API. But that's another problem. And you can work with it. If you don't like the web front end, use the API. Nearly everything the web front end supports is exposed via API. That's later topic. And there are also a bunch of command line clients which can integrate into Git to allow things like merge request, to allow you to post those merge requests from the command line if you don't like web front ends. You can also open merge requests by mail. If you still like it, you can just hit the right buttons. You get a mail address that you can use. And if you send a patch to that mail address, you will create a merge request. Some of the not so known features. Issues. You can track to-do items or bugs. Please, this is not intended for Debian packages, so please don't replace the BTS. But using it as an issue tracker or a to-do list is great. We are using it all the time. We're also having some upstream projects on Salsa, like Sane or our own code, which is not packaged. So they're using issues is fine too. Issues are disabled by default for all projects, but every project is fine to just to enable it and to use it. You can have boards where you can organize your work, you can add sprints, you can add milestones and other things. So all the basic stuff you need with an issue tracker is included. And we also enabled reply by mail, so you don't have to use the web front end. You can just use your mail client to reply and your answers in the GitLab. You can also close issues by merge requests. So similar to our BTS, GitLab has these closes features. Well, this list below is all the same. So closed, closes, closing, closing, closes, and so on is all the same. And we close your issues. You can even close issues in other projects. So if you have projects related together and you fix something in another project, you can even close it with that syntax. You can also create issues by mail, which is basically the same as for merge request. You have that email a new issue button where you get a custom mail address you can use. And then you can use that mail address from the future to submit bugs if you don't want to use the issue tracker. Let's see. Yeah. What we also got are webhooks. Custom hooks are not anymore possible because you don't have access to your GitHub repositories directly. But what you can use are webhooks. Webhooks are common standard in the web world. You can use them to react to events in your repository. Events may things like someone created an issue, someone created a pull request, someone pushed something, someone tagged something, things like that. And you can use those events to create IRC notifications. We have two IRC bots available for you to use, which is KGB and IRCA, my own IRCA instance. You can automatically close or tag bugs. If you look into our documentation in wikidebian.org, you find a small paragraph about it, where you can just, as we did before, if you close the bug and you enable the tag pending webhook, your bug will be tagged automatically as pending, like before, if you used the appropriate hooks on Alioth. And you can also trigger external CI or QI systems like Jenkins or SonyaCube or whatever you like to test your code. In the future, we will also use it for collab, for the collaboration stuff from Tinshow, where we will just forward every push happened on the whole Salsa system, so you don't have to configure that manually. That will be happen automatically. So if you contribute something to Debian, it will come up on collaboration DebianNet, a collab Debian, yeah, collab DebianNet. What? Contributors was it? What contributors? Yeah. If you want to write webhooks but you don't want to run your own web server, you can come to us. Which means you have to code Ruby. We have our own webhook server implementation for salsa.debian.org, which is currently also running on Salsa, but that must be the case in the future. So if you want to run a webhook, provide it as a patch for our webhook implementation, which is pluggable. So write a plugin, which listens to your webhooks, provide a patch, a merge request, and we'll happily add it to our webhook implementation, so it runs for can be used for everybody. Documentation is in the wiki. Currently provided hooks are, as already mentioned, tag pending, which allows you to tag bugs expanding if you mention them in a change log. And some project directly working with commits are using the close webhook, which allows you directly close a bug with a commit, which is used by some web services and other stuff directly used in Debian. One of the most powerful features we got is GitLib CI. GitLib CI is a system that allows continuous integration and continuous development on Salsa. And that allows you to build, test, and eventually deploy software and packages from within GitLab. You can nearly do whatever you want in this CI stuff. You can, as said, compile your jobs, run linter, run auto package test, whatever you can imagine you can do. We have two runners, provided, which one of it is running as an instance on Google Cloud. The other one is hardware sponsored by a sponsor. And we launch, for every CI one, we launch a Docker container in it. You can even provide an image you want to use as this one for the one. And then you can do whatever you want with it. But please don't do bit mining or something like that. Be kind to them. We all have to use them, and we have only two of them. So please, if you want to do something bigger, talk to us, like the KDE people already did. How to use it? Using GitLab CI is surprisingly easy. There is this GitLab CI YAML file, which is usually in the root of your repository. But you can add configuration to your repository, for example, to add it to your slash Debian repository, which works better for GBP packages or whatever you have if you don't want to clutter the upstream directories with your GitLab CI file. We already have a bug open at the GitLab issue tracker that allows us to change the default name of the GitLab CI file, because currently if you import an external repository which has a GitLab CI file, which can happen, it will happily run on our infrastructure, and for example, you know, it's Ansible or some other project which has it. So for every upstream commit, Salsa will happily run our runners and build the pipeline. After you edit your file, that's it. You, from then on, you can watch every commit happening on your pipeline. And this is a simple GitLab CI file. GitLab CI files are YAML-based. The documentation is in the GitLab repository, documentation repository. And as you can see, it's pretty easy. You have a pre-step, which allows you to do things like install dependencies, which is what's happening here. Since GitLab CI is running a detached head, and if you want to use Git build package, you will have to check out master for it to properly work. Then you can do a Git pull, Git build package, and after that, you have build your package. That's basically all. You can also use artifacts. Artifacts allows you to add keep build artifacts for downloading. So if you want to use a package, someone will use a package, you can just artifact stanza here, and that allows you to later download your dev files. No, that doesn't allow you to create repositories with apt. But that's another problem. If that's too much, you can also use this thing which popped up yesterday. This is a prepared Docker container, which is prepared for Git build package. And all you have to do is to execute this. After that, you have GitLab CI. I don't know who provided it, but it popped up in the wiki yesterday or something like that. But we also have GitLab pages. GitLab pages are like GitHub pages and allow you to host websites, static websites from within GitLab. Internally, they also use GitLab CI. So you provide a GitLab CI job that just deploys your website. So it's nothing to do. And here's our build artifact feature. All we do here is just add those public files in the public directory to our pages. And we only do this on the master branch. And basically, that's it. The magic is happening here, where pages, it's the pages step. And if you correctly configure pages in your repository configuration, you have a GitLab page after that. You can also do more fancy things like a Hugo website. Just depend on a Docker image which has Hugo installed, and then execute a script which builds Hugo, adds some artifacts, and after that you have a working Hugo website. You can also use it for blogs. You can use it in personal repositories, then, for example, for your own website or blogs. Of course, it's not intended to serve big websites, but providing blogs for planetdb.org is perfectly fine, for example, or websites of the Perl project or whatever is Debian related. This brings me to another topic not mentioned in my slides. Some people asked us what is fine to host on Salsa. As long as it's open source, as long as it's intended to be Debian related or to open source related or can be included in Debian, it's perfectly fine to host it on Salsa. So we invite every apps team which is looking for a home, like the same guys, to host them on Salsa. What we got with the latest major version is Web Editor, which was pretty new and probably buggy, but yeah, it works. So if you don't want to clone a repository or you have just to have simple changes, you can add your file in the Web Editor, you get a Web Editor with syntax highlighting, you get even Markdown preview if you just do documentation. So that's great for everyone just doing documentation without that doesn't want to hassle with Git or the code inside. You can even preview it. Then you can write a commit message. And that's it. What we also have is two-factor authentication, which is a security feature and allows you to add a second factor to your GitLab login. I can only recommend to use it. It's good integrated and adds a lot of security. It works with YubiKeys or any U2F compatible key, and also with software solutions that implement TOTP, time-based one-time passwords. So every TOTP compatible generator also works. For example, the Google Authenticator, but there are also others which are open source. That all works. Adding it is easy. Yeah. Well, as John Pütz would say, ich hatte da mal was vorbereitet. It's easy. What you can't see now is me getting my smartphone out, scanning the barcode, generating a PIN code, and in 2 seconds I will enter the PIN code. What you see here are recovery codes. I will mention them in a few minutes. You can use them to recover your account if you lost your one-time password generator. So if I log in now, I have to use my smartphone to generate authentication code, add it, and now I'm in. That's it. So it's pretty easy. Some people say, what is if I lost my token? That is such work. No, it's easy. If you want to recover your token, I do that all the time, you can just use SSH and do SSH git salsadb.org and the command 2FA recovery codes, which will generate you a number of new recovery codes, and you can use it to log in. So if I don't have my authentication token with me, I just use this every time. It works. And SSH is also another token. Huh? No, it works. It's the second factor. So it's fine. So here we are. The API. I have to get faster. GitHub exposes a powerful JSON REST API that allows you to query and to manipulate nearly all aspects of GitLab. If I say all, I really mean all. Nearly everything you can do with the web front end is covered by the API. The API has an extensive documentation in that link. Ensure that you use the CE for community edition in the docs. Otherwise, you will see features that, that aren't available in our edition. You can use it for everything. Small hint, you often see the term namespace ID. In nearly all cases, you can replace the namespace ID with the path of a project, of a thing, mostly projects. But if your project includes slashes, which is nearly always the case, you can you have to replace a slash with %2f. And you can use it as the namespace ID. So you don't have to look up every time your IDs. You can just use names. Some examples. Get data about your user. If you want to know what start in your user, you can just ask the API. For every use of authenticate, things that need authentication, you need to generate a private token, which is easy. Just go to your profile, and there's a link to access tokens, and generate one for your use case. You can also add expiration dates. Even when I use curl here, I can only recommend to use a proper library. Don't use curl. Please do me a favor and don't use curl. Yeah. There are a bunch of scripts flying around that use curl, and then they hit the first time pagination or something like that, and they start wondering why it doesn't work. There are Python libraries, Ruby libraries, Perl libraries for GitLab, so we have everything in place that you need. What you can do too, create a repo in your namespace. If you do it that way, the repo will be private. Of course, there are parameters to create a public repo, but that means you have to read the documentation. We had this. List open merge requests of a project. Also easy. Just go to projects, which is the namespace for our project related stuff. Add your project. It's in my case, it's the ALIO rewriter. Add a merge request. Ask for a specific state, and you get a nice formatted JSON to. Get nice JSON, you can format to list all your merge requests. So I have to get to an end. How to get support? If you have any problems with Alioth, you can of course talk to me or to Ganef. Huh? This channel is still Alioth and will probably stay for some time. You find us on IRC. You can drop us an email at salsaadmin@debian.org. We also have an issue tracker. So if you have a problem, open an issue. But please don't open upstream related stuff in our issue tracker. If you have a problem with Salsa, fine, create a ticket. If you have some problem with how GitLab is doing things, or I found a bug in GitLab, please do us a favor and open those bugs in the GitLab issue tracker, because that's the same thing we would have to do. And we want to track your bugs. How we do it. If you're interested how we did those stuff, we are all doing it unprivileged in Git on god.debian.org, and everything we do is automated via Ansible, and you find it in our Ansible repository in the Salsa group on salsa.debian.org. Where are we? Who are we? Salza currently has three administrators. It's Bastian Svaldi, Jörg Jaspert, Ganev here, and me. My picture is gone. What you would have to see here is a thanks picture. Thank you for your attention. And we have maybe 1 or 2 minutes left for questions.
Right. Yes. I have a quick question about SSO going down with... Is SSO going down with Elioth on
no.
1st of June?
But as mentioned in my announcement, I usually do write announcements, and I hope people read it. I will back up the authentication database of Elioth to Diabelli DBN org, which is the host running SSO, and I will maintain those users by hand until we have the new SSO backend ready.
Quick. So if there's people going to the register for DebConf, which are not Debian developers. In Taiwan, can they still register after 1st of June or not?
They can't use SSO anymore for registration, but they did implement a second authentication. Okay. But
it's been okay, cool. Any further questions?
Sorry. It's been 3 years since DebConf doesn't need SSO.
Okay. Like any further questions on Salsa?
I have a little question about Salsa at all. There is some how-tos, how to create an account on Salsa, how to manipulate that account to create repositories, for example. I mean, just for people who never came to it, to get used to not read the ton of documentation.
Except from user registration, there is nothing specific on salsa.debian.org, so you can just use the GitLab documentation, which has videos, webcasts, tutorials, and so on. Just use it. It's good documentation. Nearly everything is covered by it. And if you have still questions after that, ask us. If you have Debian-specific stuff, look at the wiki. wikidebian.org/salsa/doc has nearly everything, I hope, most things covered. If not, tell us. And in the end, it's a wiki. So if you find something out, think it's interesting for other people, please add it to the wiki.
Any other questions? Okay, everything's answered. Thanks a lot again.